Lovely. Okay. Well, I think we're going to go ahead and start. So thank you so much for everyone who is in attendance today. Hopefully this is going to be a really useful presentation for everyone who is attending probably their first conference, although I know we have some people in attendance who've been, been to conferences before. Hopefully this will also be useful for you guys too. And so I'm going to start off by, as I said, welcoming you all and also introducing myself and my co-presenter today, Dr. Tim O'Connell. So I'm Dr. Jen Smith. I am associated with the Association of Field Ornithologists. I'm an assistant professor at University of Texas at San Antonio. I'm an ornithologist, as many of us in this room are today. And if you have any questions after the presentation today, please feel free to reach out to me at my email that I provided there. Tim, do you want to say a few words about yourself?
Sure. If there are questions for me, please reach out to me at Jen Smith's email. That would be wonderful.
Or you can use Tim O'Connell's.
Or you can use mine. No, it is great to be here. And another example of our two societies kind of working together. And because we share a common goal, and that common goal is to help people get more out of what our societies have to offer. And that's what we want to talk about a little bit today.
Yeah. Thank you for that. Okay. I'm going to see if my technology works here. Okay. So right. Tim, I'm going to hand over to you.
For participants today, Jen and I are going to sort of switch back and forth to sort of break things up a little bit. We've got some prepared remarks for you. And then, of course, we want to have lots of time available for your questions. Our two societies, the AFO and the Wilson Ornithological Society, which I represent, we have a long history of working together on joint projects. We very often sort of have our conferences together, like a joint conference. But what you're experiencing today is something that we started to do just in the past year, and that is a series of joint live webinars, making use of the technology that most of us know how to use now, to get some messaging out about the sort of things that we do and to help support ornithologists, which is what we do. So this is the third. The first one, we did one that was related to careers in ornithology outside of academia. We had our next one, which was a couple of months ago, was about safety in the field. And then today, because we're getting to conference season, we just want to talk about conferences. You go ahead, Jen. So, if you're new to this, you might be wondering what the heck we're really talking about and what conferences are all about in general. So I'll just start real basic, and that's that, you know, scientists for a long, long time have sort of coalesced around forming societies. And societies are kind of membership based, and they serve as sort of like hubs of information and communication and networking for people working on similar things. Especially like in the olden days, a couple centuries ago, the societies would get the best of their scientific information together, the most like rigorous information they had, and they would publish it and archive it in a journal, in a peer-reviewed journal. And then scientists would subscribe to that journal, and that's how they'd learn the science that everyone else was doing. The other thing societies would do is have annual meetings and get people together and really talk. And in the days before Zoom, that was hugely important. And then they all sort of have a mandate or a mission to mentor that next generation of scientists. There are probably hundreds, maybe thousands of scientific societies, from the really general, like the American Association for the Advancement of Science, are the ones who publish the journal Science. And then subgroups within science have their own societies, like ornithological societies. And that's what we are. Next slide, please. The AFO and the WOS are both scientific societies dedicated to the study of birds and the support of people who study birds. But we're not the only two scientific societies. As you'll see on the next slide, there's a whole bunch of different societies that are all sort of bird focused. And these are primarily those active in the New World, but I've also got the British Ornithologist Union up there too. So sometimes we'll have a conference and there might be six or seven different societies that are all meeting jointly. And then sometimes these individual societies will meet on their own. Almost all of them have something that sort of sets them apart. For example, the Pacific Seabird Group is, you know, really dedicated to birds of the Pacific Ocean that are seabirds, you know. The, you know, Raptor Research Foundation is really focused on raptors. Others are more general. In the Association of Field Ornithologists and the Wilson Ornithological Society will publish on any birds, any topic. Next one, please.
Thanks, Tim. Okay, so Tim introduced the different ornithological societies, mainly here in North America. There's a lot of different ornithology societies beyond our borders here in North America. So if you are from outside of the States, I encourage you to look those up. But here today, we're presenting on behalf of AFO and Wilson. So we just wanted to talk a little bit more specifically about those organizations. Here I'm representing AFO. I've been involved and affiliated closely with AFO for a while now, probably like 6-8 years. Yeah, something like that. And so I just want to kind of go through what our focus is with all of you today. So AFO is committed to studying and conservation of birds in their natural habitat. We bridge between professional and amateur ornithologists. So to be members and involved with our society, you do not have to be a professional ornithologist. And we encourage people who are into birds, non-professional banders, for example, to be involved as well. We have a strong focus on Latin America. So this involves doing things like outreach with our Latin American counterparts and colleagues, having scientific meetings not only in North America, but also in Latin America, which we'll come on to in a minute. And we also have grant programs focusing not only on North America, but also encouraging Latin American ornithology to students who are either working in Latin America or who are from specifically Latin American countries. We offer lots of opportunities to contribute to and support the ornithology profession, and that can be from anyone who's a professional ornithologist or not, to also students, right, who are also professional ornithologists like yourselves. So if you're interested in taking part as and supporting AFO, that could be on committees, that could be helping out at conferences, lots of other opportunities, social media. We're also looking, always looking for people to help with social media and things like that. So please reach out if you're interested in doing that. It can be a great way to meet other people in the ornithology community, get points on your CVs too, which is really, really valuable. And so membership for students is really affordable and also for professionals. And why become a member of AFO? So in doing so, you're supporting professional and amateur ornithologists. You're providing support for meetings, our grant programs, all of the good things that we're doing in the ornithological community. You also have discounts to banding supplies through our company Avinet. And also we have events such as this, which have access only to members, and also grants are only available to folk who are members too. So lots of benefits of being associated and a member of AFO. And so kind of briefly mentioned Avinet. Just want to give a plug to Avinet Research Supplies, who are a company who are owned by AFO and managed by BRI. And we, if you bought banding equipment, chances are that you bought it from Avinet. We supply lots of different things beyond ornithological research, with a big focus on bat research too. So if you're coming up to your field season, you need banding pliers, bird bags, anything like that, please check out our website. As I said, as a member, you get discounts too. So a great reason to be a member. And then kind of a quick plug for our upcoming meeting. If you've seen the logo, you will know that it's our centenary year this year. So we're 100 years old this year, which is really exciting for everyone who's a member of AFO. We are having a celebratory meeting, our annual meeting in Plymouth, Massachusetts, between the 10th to the 13th of October 2022. Still plenty of opportunities to submit abstracts for that meeting and to register for the early bird registration fee. So if you're interested in attending, we hope you are, please visit afonet.org, where there's a link to the meeting website. So I'm going to pass you back on to Tim right now.
Thank you, Jen. Ditto all that, right? So Just about any ornithological society, as I mentioned, will do the general things. They'll publish a journal, they'll have annual meetings, they'll have programs that support ornithologists at different levels. Like our friends at the AFO, the Wilson Ornithological Society is also really interested in mentoring people, whether they're professional ornithologists or not. We're also active in Latin America. We also support students, right? But the different societies kind of discriminate or distinguish themselves with different areas in which they have strengths or emphases. So you heard from Jen about the particularly strong link that the AFO has built with Latin American colleagues. And that's great. That's an amazing thing. The other one is that Avanet is unique to AFO. Like they've got this company that works with or is part of the society. And that's something that sort of sets them apart. At the Wilson Ornithological Society, we've been around for a really long time. I just figured out last week we're 1 year older than the Eiffel Tower. So we were 134 years into this bird business. Currently, what we're publishing is the Wilson Journal of Ornithology. We provide a lot of research grants and mentoring. Our particular strength is probably in the realm of undergraduate mentorship. Like we just have a lot of programs that are geared to undergrads and both for mentoring and to support their research. Next one, please. Here's just a quick look. The folks in the panel on the left are a brand new mentorship program that we've got that we're starting this year, in which they're spending some specific training time with people on our council. They're invited to our council meeting, which is happening tomorrow, and they're sort of getting special behind the scenes looks at how things work at our upcoming annual meeting that I'll talk about in a second. All those good looking folks on the right just got research grants from us. So there are lots of different categories of research grants available at all levels. So from professional ornithologist to PhD and postdoc level, undergraduate, we've even funded some high school projects in the past. So we've got the ability to do that, which is wonderful. And it really helps support a lot of people, especially sort of when they're getting started in their careers. Next one. As I mentioned, we've been publishing for a long time. Our current journal is the Wilson Journal of Ornithology, and we're publishing about 1,000 pages a year in four issues. And that's a combination of the kind of papers you've seen in other journals where there are like research articles. But one thing that we do that's kind of a holdover from the past is we still publish like descriptive life history notes. And most journals don't do that anymore. So there are a lot of like weird little observations out there in the ornithological world that aren't necessarily, you know, the result of some big science project. It's just a really cool observation. We're a place where that stuff can still make it into print, and then it's archived and searchable, and other ornithologists can learn that, which is pretty cool. We're also real proud of the fact that a good proportion, like a big proportion of our authors in our journal are, it's their first authorship, like the, and then the first listed name, like the person who's the lead author is a student, which is super cool. And a lot of us who are professional ornithologists today, like we got our first paper published in the Wilson Journal of Ornithology or the Wilson Bulletin, its previous iteration. Also, about 40% of our authors are coming from countries outside the US. So all of our societies, even though we might be focused, US or even North America or New World, we've got an international presence. And we're proud of that. And it takes extra effort to sort of help a lot of authors from different countries get their publications in a peer-reviewed journal too. So that's a great thing we're doing editorially. Next one. Our upcoming meeting is just a month from today. We're gonna be in beautiful Santa Fe, New Mexico. And maybe some of the folks on the call today are people who are already sort of lined up for that meeting and are giving a presentation or something like that. It's going to be a pretty typical meeting. Jen's going to talk about sort of what happens at a basic ornithological meeting in a couple of minutes. But ours includes all those things. It's people giving talks, it's posters, it's special lectures, it's training, it's a banquet, field trips, social time. Well, we hope we can have field trips. Right now, New Mexico's on fire. But the monsoons have started. So I'm encouraged that we're going to be able to get out and find some cool birds too. Next one. There are so many things that we work with our friends at the AFO on, and we coordinate activities. One of those is that we intentionally keep our student membership rate the same as AFO's. because we don't want to undercut them or anything like that. And in the olden days, like when I was an undergrad, what ornithologists did was they had a membership to all the ornithologic societies, or at least all the ones they could afford. And people just generally don't do that today, but there's just a lot of overlap, and a lot of us have memberships to multiple societies, and we really do get along well and collaborate on a bunch of different things. Some of the things that that we distinguish ourselves in the Wilson Ornithological Society, I mentioned that we're really strong with student opportunities. That includes we involve students in our governance. So there is a student and early professionals committee. They do a lot of activities around it throughout the year, but especially at our meeting. And there's also student positions on our council. So people can sort of, for one, get networking with more senior people, build their network out of like working with people, not just meeting them, and getting lots of great sort of administrative experience. And you can visit us at wilsonsociety.org. And I'll let Jen take over from there.
Thanks, Tim. Sorry. Okay, so here's kind of going on from what we said today. We're here to talk about conferences, right? So one-on-one to conferences, specifically aimed at folk who might be new to conferences. And so kind of to dive in, to start with, what is an annual meeting? You might have heard of this called a conference, right? And so specifically AFO and Wilson's, we both have societies annually, so once annually. And its aim is, all their aims are to build community, share information, right? So your research, for example, network, meet other ornithologists, either amateur or professional, engage in professional development, that can be really important early in your career, and conduct the business of the society. And we'll get on to kind of how we do those things in a minute. Those meetings are often hosted at a hotel, a conference center, and sometimes college campuses too. Meetings across the societies, remember Tim introduced all those different societies in North America, they can be anywhere from 100 people up to, I think the NEOC had like 4,000 people when we had it online. But for AFO and Wilson's, we actually, in my opinion, offer kind of a more intimate kind of meeting, which is really nice. And if you don't like going to big meetings, come to either an AFO Wilson's or one of our joint meetings is a really good way to kind of meet people very easily, because our meetings are typically between 200-250 people, right Tim? That's about Wilson's size too.
Yeah, like 100, maybe 100 to 250.
Yeah, so kind of a smaller end of meetings. And certainly when I started going to conferences, my first one was AOS in Portland, 2008, and it was massive. It's the first time I ever came to America. It was brilliant, but very daunting. And so like, I actually really like going to our meetings, because they're kind of really friendly, small kind of vibe going on. And so who attends, right? So we talked a little bit about who our different societies serve. So it's not only scientists and professors and academic folk, but we also encourage people like land managers to come, and other non-professional ornithologists, also graduate students, undergraduate students. Sometimes we even have high school students attend, which is excellent. And then vendors, so people like Avinet, and also family members sometimes as well. So a big question is, why attend an ornithology meeting? I think lots of people have different goals, but some of the key ones are you get to learn all about ornithology, things that you didn't know before, from someone who's at their first conference to someone who's been in the profession for 40, 50 years, you're gonna learn something new, right? Scientists are always asking questions, finding out new things about ornithology. It's a really exciting way to learn about cutting edge science. And then also to get new research ideas from listening to talks or talking to other people, and things like that. Going on to that, networking is a really big component of meetings. So getting to know people that maybe you've met on social media, or maybe there's professors who you want to reach out to and talk to and find out about grad school opportunities or about what kind of research they're doing. So networking, creating connections is a really pivotal point for attending ornithology or any conference, professional conference. And then sharing your research, right? As scientists or amateur ornithologists, we're often collecting data, conducting research. And so part of the scientific process is disseminating those findings, but also talking about your research as you're going on, right? Trying to get more ideas to try and improve or further your research. This is a really good way to do that. And so what's an ornithology conference look like? So there's a lot of things going on at ornithology conferences. So I'll go through some of the key ones now. I want to make a point that ornithology conferences differ depending on who's hosting and also the size and also things like the budget that conferences have. But the things that Tim and I are going to present today really pertain to AFO and Wilson's conferences pretty nicely. So typically we have what are known as keynote or plenary lectures, and they are typically given at a prominent position in a schedule, often like either at a lunchtime or early in the morning. And typically everyone at the at the conference attends. They're not hosted at the same time as anything else. It's kind of a keynote. Everyone is encouraged to attend. They're often an hour in length. They're often given by prominent scientists in the community to recognize lifetime achievement, or we also have some that recognize early career stars. I know, for example, a handful of years ago, we had Dr. James Dwyer, who's a biologist, looks at crested caracaras, gave a plenary at the AFO conference. In the one in Chattanooga, Dr. Reed Bowman, who some of you will know, who is a director, current director at the Ornithology Lab, Archibald Biological Station, gave like a summary of his research over his career at Archibald Biological Station on scrub jays. So really great talks to go to. If you go to conferences, I really suggest that you don't skip those. They're fascinating and amazing lectures. So really important to go to those. Kind of going on from that, we also host symposiums, or symposia, sorry, the plural, right? Which is often a group of invited talks. And so you might have emails from people who are hosting this symposium asking you to give talks in those symposia. And if you do, I would encourage you to accept that invitation if you're able to attend the conference. So these are usually a series of short talks, about 15 minutes in length, with time for questions at the end. And they're often organized around a common theme. For example, one could be effects on avian influenza on seabird nesting colonies. And so those are typically run at the same time as other symposia. So often you have to choose which one to go to. So I'm going to switch back to Tim.
Sure. Like the bread and butter at a conference are these talks, these little short talks or oral presentations. And so those can be like most of a day will be taken up with sessions of these talks. Very often there are concurrent sessions. So there'll be, you know, maybe two or three different rooms in which talks are happening at the same time. And then you, as the consumer of that information at an ornithological conference, you're either sort of picking one room and just going to stay in that room because you like the talks that are on that list, or you might be sort of picking and choosing, well, I need to be in this room because I want to see this talk, but then right after that, I need to be in this other room because I really want to see that talk. So that's why the schedule is so important and we're rigorous about that. And we keep the time very strictly. So you know that every talk ends exactly at the time that it's supposed to end. And that gives people the chance to leave one room and go to the next one for concurrent talks. That's a good way to approach it as someone who just wants to sort of, learn about ornithology in general, is allow yourself to sort of go through the schedule that's prepared ahead of time and pick and choose the ones you might want to see based on the title or the abstract. If the abstract is available, you can read that ahead of time. Let's see. So each session of those, what we call contributed oral presentations, is usually about an hour long, and we usually have four of them in that hour. So each speaker is allotted 15 minutes, and that's it. You should also recognize that you don't have to go to every single talk. You don't have to fill your entire day going to every talk while there's a talk going on. You want to take a break? Take a break. It's so much information coming at you at one time, it's hard to sort of absorb it anyway. So kind of pace yourself and go listen to the talks that you want to listen to. Don't force yourself to listen to talks that maybe are not that interesting to you, but also be open to the fact that maybe you'll be surprised by something that's more interesting than you thought it was. But that's what the oral presentations are about. Next one, please. There'll also be at least one, sometimes two, discrete events, usually in the evening, and usually organized around a bit of a social. Maybe there'll be some snacks. There might even be an open bar happening while this is going on. And this will be not in sort of the smaller meeting rooms where there's sit-down opportunities, but in sort of a big open space. And this is the poster presentations. There are things I like about poster sessions. There are things I hate about poster sessions. For me, just it can be pretty noisy. And oftentimes it's difficult for me to want to be in there when there's all this sort of background noise. But poster sessions are an essential part of our scientific meetings, and you're going to see them. Some of you might be already preparing poster for upcoming conferences. A poster should be, a lot of people, especially if you're a little bit more introverted, you might be thinking, oh, I'm going to put my information on my poster and then I won't have to talk to anyone. And sadly, that's not how posters work. The entire point of a poster is to get you to give your talk to a whole bunch of people, one right after another, after another, after another. So it's very much an oral presentation. You're just using some graphical prompts behind you. And I like to tell my students that a poster is it's like an invitation to a conversation. The point is not to have people just walk by and read what you've got so you don't have to talk to them. The point is to have something up there that's really cool that makes them want to talk to you. And then you have that conversation about the work that you've done. Next one, please. If you are preparing your own talk, I'm sure you're getting, or hope you're getting, advice from your mentor or whoever you're working with on the research you're going to be presenting. But just a couple of things to pay attention to. 15 minutes is going to go by like that. So it's, if you're in one of those, even a 20-minute talk, if you have a 20-minute time slot, it's going to go quickly. So you want to make sure that you can get through the information you want to present at a nice, relaxed pace, and that you're practiced enough so you know you can finish on time. And on time doesn't mean when they get the hook and pull you off. On time means leaving a couple of minutes, usually at least 3 minutes, to allow people to ask questions. And that's important too, because it gives people the chance to get up and move to another room if they want to. When any kind of presentation you're giving, your goal is not to sort of tell the audience everything you did or how hard you worked or how difficult the field work was or anything like that. Your goal is to have one consistent message and craft your presentation around that one message and get that one thing across that somebody can remember. And craft it as a story. Tell a good story about the work you've done, and then you'll have a great experience. No one is going to be mean to you. If they are, send them to me. No one's going to be mean to you and tell you that you did your stats wrong and you're a bad scientist. That's just not going to happen. And let's see, what else? Oh yeah, if you are giving a talk in a particular session, it is both polite and also it works well if you commit to stay there for the entire session. So you're going to need to be there right at the beginning. Even if you're the last speaker in that session, you need to be there when it starts to make sure your talk is loaded and everything's ready to go. And then it's good practice to stay in that room the entire time. For a poster, the biggest problem that students will encounter in preparing a poster is having it not fit. So you want to make sure that you know ahead of time the dimensions of the poster for you to make, and you'll be instructed on that from the society, from the people who are organizing the scientific session. Standard would be these sort of 8-foot wide frames, and you can fit two posters on those in landscape orientation if you want, and theoretically they can be 48 inches wide, but that doesn't leave any room from one to the next. So I think a good practice is to like not make anything wider than 46 inches if you're making a poster. When you make your poster, you're gonna have too many words on that poster. So you should cut half of the words out after you make your poster. And then after you do that, you're still gonna have too many words on your poster. So cut even more and just use the graphics to sort of invite the conversation and tell the story. There shouldn't be any complete sentences anywhere on your poster. It should just be sort of the bare minimum of words to get somebody interested in what you're doing so you can start to have a conversation. And posters, you know, the poster room can be loud. It can be kind of crowded sometimes. So you need to be sort of concerned about yourself in that situation too. And that means make sure you're gonna be talking a lot. So make sure you pre-hydrate. So get plenty to drink, water ahead of time, and comfortable shoes. Like if you decide you wanna dress up for your poster session, and you've got a great pair of shoes, that pair of shoes better be great for standing for a long time, because that's what you're going to be doing. Is it still me, Jen, or are we on to you yet?
It is me.
Okay, great.
Some great tips there. Comfortable shoes are pretty key for a conference. Okay. So we've talked about how kind of scientific information is disseminated at conferences, but there's other things which go on too. So for example, we often host workshops. In fact, most meetings I've ever been to have had workshops either at the beginning or at the end of the conference. And these provide specific training in things like bird banding, specifically at AFO conferences. We often have our workshops too, which are focused on, it can be focused on people who haven't used R or kind of more complex analysis. And the photo, I just wanted to highlight the photo that I put on here of some of the folk from Archbold. We were fortunate enough at the joint meeting of Wilson's and AFO and Cape May to have collaborative support from CTT Technologies, and we hosted this great workshop which helped users put back or teach users how to put back telemetry devices on birds. So that's just a really good example of something that we've hosted before. Often there's also student and young professional focused events. They can either be socials or more kind of workshop oriented things. There's increasing presence of events promoting inclusive practices, diversity and equity, which is at the forefront of our minds. It's really important for us to do those things. We also typically have events focused on Meet the Editors. So this for AFO is the Journal of Field Ornithology. And then Tim spoke about Wilson's. It's Wilson's, but it's not Wilson's Bulletin, I'm so sorry. Journal of Wilson's Ornithology.
Wilson Journal.
I'm sorry, Tim. I always kind of get that one mixed up. But basically, the events are we have the editors of the journal, and then sometimes we have the associate editors. And that's a chance for folk who are interested in publishing coming to talk to us about how you publish and all of those kind of things that can be really good. Many of the workshops and other events are pre-register. And so as you're registering for the conference, there's often a click down menu to select the ones that you might want to go to. They fill up fast, some of them, so be on top of that. And then even if you haven't registered, get to the conference and you see something you like, it's always worth asking the conference organizers if there's space to attend those as well. And some of these things are really important to attend, not only because they can help you professionally, but they can go on your CV to showcase that you've learned new skills at those conferences too. Some other things that go on. So if you're affiliated or are involved with a society, often we have society meetings. We also host business meetings, which are available for all of our membership to attend. They're usually pretty quick. They happen normally around a lunchtime, and it's an opportunity to hear what's been going on in the society. They have the election, so who, for example, is going to be on council. So as membership, you get an opportunity to vote yes or no. And we also reveal information about where our next meeting is going to be and exciting things happening, how your membership dues are being spent. So it's a really good opportunity to find out about those things. It's also a great opportunity to meet leadership in society if you want to participate in the organization. So in this case, either AFO or Wilson's, come meet us after those events. We'll be excited to talk to you about any ideas you have for the society, or if you want to be involved too. Then we have social events. This is a really good way to network and meet people. And these can either occur kind of more formally or informally. It's not only, mentor mentee type social events, but it's also opportunities to have a bit of fun. Some of the ornithological societies host quiz bowls, so specifically for students to test your knowledge about ornithology. These are pretty hardcore. They're a lot of fun. There's some pretty tough questions, but everyone gets pretty competitive. It's a good time. We often have music at societies as well in the evening as a social event. And then also we have more organized events. So for example, we often host an LGBTQI plus allies social as well. And then we have exhibitors and vendors, and these tables are often positioned around the posters, so you get an opportunity to go and see the posters, and then you can go and talk to people who you might want to buy equipment from. At AFO meetings, we always have our banding supplies company, Avonet, attend. So if you're interested in looking at the latest banding pliers or other equipment, you have some questions about mist nets you've bought, come and talk to us about those kind of things. Sometimes we have telemetry companies attend as well, and then publishers of books. So lots of people to kind of find out about new technology and see the tools of the trade, if it were. And then also sometimes we have silent auctions. As a heads up, Tim, I don't know if you've heard, we are going to have a silent auction at our centenary meeting in Massachusetts for AFO. We're looking for people to donate items for that. Heads up, there's going to be some pretty cool crafts coming from council members. Oh. There are, so look out for those. There might be some knitting involved. and so that's a really cool opportunity to get some really cool artifacts, bird-related artifacts. And then we also have award banquets. These are at all meetings typically, where you celebrate people who've won awards. There's often a talk from the president, for example. We find out who's got student awards and all those kind of things. It's often a kind of a fancier meal, a sit down or buffet, and it's also usually associated with the closing ceremony. So just an example of this is the bottom picture here. If you can see in the middle, there's one Dr. Tim O'Connell sporting a very nice bow tie, sat with a bunch of my students, which is a really lovely moment for me. So yes, that's a really good example of what the awards banquet might look like. And then really exciting, you might have noticed, but a lot of our conferences are often held in pretty nice locations. We try to meet somewhere which is birdy, so high bird biodiversity, because we're ornithology folk. Not all ornithologists are birders, as a key point to point out, but a lot of us are, and a lot of us enjoy kind of going on field trips which are nature and bird oriented. And so this is just a suite of photos. I've been incredibly fortunate in my career to date to go to some amazing meetings, and so there's a bunch of people who are in the room today who have fortunate enough to go to Iguazu Falls a couple of years ago in Argentina, but some of the other ones are Kate May photos for our combined meeting with Wilson's, and then this is the meeting up in Alaska. And I want to point out that some of these locations might seem like, oh, I can never afford to go there. Well, how did you afford to go there? We're going to come on to talk about other ways that you can get funding. So don't ever think that these opportunities aren't available to you. There's usually ways that you can work out ways to get funding. And as societies, we're working on ways to make these meetings more inclusive and provide money to support students. And if you've got any questions about that, please feel free to reach out to me and Tim about that. So I'm going to pass you back to Tim.
Yeah, that last point was great, Jen. You know, for the meeting that we've got coming up next month, the Wilson Ornithological Society, just for student travel, we've mobilized $15,000 to help students get to that meeting. So, you know, we really, as societies, we often talk about, like, your budget determines your values or reflects your values, right? So when we decide we want to do something or we decide something's important, we put money behind it and try to make that happen. So there's a whole bunch of students who are able to come to our meeting next month who otherwise wouldn't be, because they've got travel money from us. And of course, AFO does this, all the societies do that to the best of their ability. So that's something to be paying attention to as you are thinking about some advanced planning for a conference you might be doing in the future. You can save money. Sometimes you can save money by purchasing a membership. Sometimes the registration costs are quite a bit less if you're already a member. We offer free memberships for any student who presents at a meeting, so that's another way to keep costs down. The registration will take place in two phases. There'll be an early bird registration that'll be a lot cheaper, so planning ahead is helpful. The hotels can often be pretty expensive, even though we do our best to make things as cheap as possible. So you want to be looking maybe for room sharing options and asking about that if that's something you need to do. Sometimes we'll make even more money available for students who might volunteer to help out at the meeting. We might need people to sort of help with the AV in the meeting rooms during the contributed talks, or we're having people sort of help out at the registration desk, you know, and just be sort of an information hub for folks coming in. So you'll get either a discounted registration for that or some other, you know, bonus, you know, travel monies or something like that. So a lot of that stuff is that's what happens well before the conference. And these are ways that you can sort of bridge that gap with what money you might have and what we can offer to help get you there. Next one, please. Conference clothing. A lot of people always want to know, like, what's the vibe at a conference and do I have to be super dressed up? Well, you don't want to be too casual, just because the part of the things that you might be doing is, you know, meeting potential employers. So you might have opportunities for, like, an impromptu, like, interview with somebody's lab or somebody it might be in a position to hire you to do ornithological work. So you don't want to be too sloppy, but you do want to be, just make sure you're comfortable and neat and presentable. And if you do those things, then I think you'll be in great shape. Some people do decide, especially for the banquet, to get pretty fancied up. I don't know why I started wearing bow ties at ornithological conference banquets, but it's something I've been doing for like 20 years now. And I just do that just to look like a weirdo. One of the cool things you could see at an ornithological conference are some of the greatest bird-themed clothes you can imagine. I remember there was one woman years ago who had these fantastic pants that were just yellow-breasted chats all over her pants. And she was codenamed Chat Pants. So yeah, let's see your best ornithological garb if you've got it. Don't be scared to wear it there. If any place, that'd be the place to wear it. Snacks can be important. So you know, you'll have set meal times, but you know, you might need something else to bridge, and maybe you get to the coffee break a little bit late and somebody's eaten all the Danish, guilty as charged. So it's a good idea to have some things on your own. Another sort of habit of mine when I'm at a conference is I just keep my backpack with me everywhere I go. And that thing is filled with food that I buy just so I have it on hand for when I meet students at the meeting. Sometimes healthful snacks like granola bars, and sometimes just chocolate. So I might just, if you find me, I might just have food on me, and don't be bashful about asking. Because you might be meeting people and doing like some actual networking, it's a good idea to, if you've got a business card, to have that with you, or just some way, something you can hand someone if you have a cool conversation, that they have the ability to sort of remember you and be able to get back in touch with you. Next one, please. it's a great idea for anything you do to like, do it with intentionality, right? If you're going to go to a conference, which is a big thing, it's maybe something you've never done before. Think about what you want to get out of that. Think about what, like how you want to grow from this experience, and then sort of make those things happen. So obviously you're going to learn a ton of ornithology. It's like drinking from a fire hose. You're going to get so much information, but you're also going to be meeting not only people who might hire you, but also peers. You're developing a peer group and people you might be end up working sort of side by side with on into the future. That's how I met Jen. I met her at a conference somewhere. I don't remember which one, but you know, we didn't have any other connection other than just meeting at a conference and like, oh, well, she's smart and seems to get a lot of work done. And then you find you're working with those people on different things as you progress. So those are the kind of things, you know, building community with the society, building community with a peer group of your own, and making those connections with people who might be at different levels than you, graduate students, professors, other potential employers. So a great opportunity to get just wonderful career advice, mentoring advice, and networking. As I mentioned before, sort of picking and choosing what talks you want to go to is important, but just like read the whole program and see what's available so you can sort of chart out your time. You might decide, you know, there's a few talks in this morning session that I want to go to, but I'm not really jazzed by those. Maybe I'll spend that time going birding. So that's a totally cool thing to do. If you just want to play hooky from the talks for a few hours, you can do that, especially if you get a little, you know, group of chums together and you're out there in the field and you're going to be making memories and experiencing the world in really important and meaningful ways. If you've done that advanced planning, maybe you even have a list of people you want to talk to ahead of time. So maybe you're really interested in working in with waterfowl or something like that. So maybe you go through the program and you see like the same name keeps popping up in all the waterfowl talks. Well, that's an indication to you. It's like, oh, I should probably meet that person. Let me find out who this person is and where they work and what they do and what kind of people they hire, that kind of thing. And it's also okay to connect people ahead of time. So you can send an email if there's somebody you really want to talk to. Go ahead and shoot them a message and ask you, are you planning to be at the meeting? I'd love to have a chance to talk to you, that kind of thing. That's totally okay to do. Next one. Yes.
Are we switching over?
Go for it. Go for it.
Yeah. So I was going to do, sorry, Tim, I got out of track of who was doing which side.
I just stopped looking at my cheat sheet. So I don't know. I'm relying on you now, Jen.
Great. sorry about that. Sorry. So kind of actually I just wanted to point out something Tim said about conference clothing, which is something I always get asked about all the time. So for my students in the lab, I often suggest Googling the conference that they're going to, and often pictures will come up on Google of, you know, scenes at the, or photos taken at the conference. So often you can see what folk are wearing. So that's a pro tip to try and work out what kind of the flavor of clothing is. But the key is wear something comfortable. And as I just want to reiterate what Tim said about, think about the fact that you could meet a potential employer. So comfortable and that. Those are the key.
And so, Jen, sometimes the rooms are super air conditioned. So layer is important too.
Gosh,
right?
Yes, I totally forgot. So it could be 110, it could be in Phoenix, Arizona, and it's 110 degrees outside. Chances are you'll need a sweatshirt because conference facilities love to put AC on. So just remember, layering is important. Thanks, Tim. That's a very good point. So during the conference, one key thing, networking, right? And so you're there potentially to make connections with future employees, people who are interested in their research, for example. And so networking is really important because, as I said, it allows you to make connections, develop a support network, get new ideas for your research, and also combat isolation if, for example, you feel isolated in your research. I just wanted to kind of highlight kind of how this has worked for me using a personal example. And so my first ever conference in North America, in fact, my first ever big conference as a PhD student, was at the joint meeting of AAU, COS and SEO in Portland in 2008. And I went here, and I've never been to America before. It's my first conference giving a talk. I was terrified. But I was very fortunate that my PhD supervisor, Dr. Jim Reynolds, introduced me to Dr. Reed Bowman, who is our Archibald Biological Station, and also our former president, Dr. Dan Ardia. And so through these meetings, I developed research networks. I ended up actually working at Archibald Biological Station, and also I became a council member at AFO. And it's not without kind of networking at these meetings, I wouldn't have had those opportunities. And so honestly, I really attribute where I'm at today partly to networking at meetings. And I was, you know, nervous about networking at those meetings, but with the help of my PhD supervisor and meeting these amazing people, really friendly people at these meetings, it's really progressed my career. I wouldn't be where I am without those meetings and those networking opportunities. And this is just a photo of the AFO crew, many of them who I met in Portland in 2008. So it's really, really cool.
Put the cursor on Reed.
Reed Bowman. This is Reed Bowman here.
There it is. Okay.
And look, here's Dan. And here's Matt Schumann, who's in this meeting today. Anyway. All right. So some tips and tricks of networking. What are your objectives? Going back to what Tim said about why you're at the meeting. Do you want to meet a future employee? Are you looking for advice about, for example, MISNETs? Have your questions ready. Come prepared. And that could be having questions written down on a piece of paper. There's no problem doing that. If a student comes up to me and they want to ask me a question, they get out of, I'm not going to, you know, judge them if they've got questions written down. It shows organisation. It's fantastic, you know. Connect ahead of time. People are busy at meetings. There's a finite amount of time. And so sometimes you might see someone across the room who you want to talk with. You might not see them again at that meeting. So I always suggest to students in my lab, and this goes to me too as a member of my lab, connect with those people ahead of time. Sometimes you can work out who's going to be at meetings if you've got opportunity to look at the schedule, or you might have heard on social media who's going to be at a meeting. Or even if you don't know someone's going to be at a meeting, reach out to them, say, hey, are you going to be at the AOS meeting next week? I'm really interested to talk to you. Can we find opportunity to talk? Do that ahead of time. It's a really good tip to do that. Also ask peers, mentors, advisors to introduce you to relevant people. It can be daunting making that first step to go to talk to someone. If you know someone who already knows them, you've got a way in to talk to that person. It can be a way more comfortable situation for yourself if you're nervous about talking to someone. And this, I created this slide for when I was doing a lot of stuff with the NEOC, which is another conference a few years back. So it's more pertinent to that. But the points here are relevant to all meetings. So increasingly common is a presence on social media. For example, Twitter, Slack, Facebook, Instagram, for all these different conferences. We often have a conference hashtag. So if you do use social media, follow the conferences online, determine what that conference hashtag is. It's a great way to find out information, who's presenting, if there's been any changes in the schedule, for example. To that point, it's increasingly common for societies to publish a social media kind of code of conduct or best practice. And so that's really important to be aware of what the policies are for social media for the conferences. They tend to vary across conferences, so always read the specific one for the conference that you're attending. And also during networking, not only on social media, but when you're at networking face-to-face, act professionally. So really key. Remember, these people could be future lab members or collaborators or future employees. And so Tim, I'm gonna go back to you.
Sure. When there is someone you want to talk to, even if it's somebody really senior and it's intimidating, you see them and they're in a big crowd and they're surrounded by other people, Very often we're just talking to our friends because this is when we see them live, is at our conferences, and we're probably just sharing stories about our kids or something like that. So it's totally okay to walk up, and don't worry about like interrupting people. Don't interrupt them and be rude, but don't think that you can't approach them and talk to them. You can. So some of the stuff that we've talked about, if you're thinking about it maybe with a more cynical eye, like I often have, you realize there are avenues where you can get into trouble. So we're at a conference, there are people who are like away from home, and sometimes their inhibitions are a little bit lower. Some people might be alcohol involved. And sometimes the sort of things that Jen and I have been talking about involve you like sharing your contact information with somebody else. So that's why it's so important to keep all of those interactions as professional and clear as possible, because there are opportunities, or there have been examples in the past, where some of those interactions have been misconstrued and have led to problems. So that's a really important thing about keeping everyone as safe and relaxed and comfortable as possible at our conferences. That's something that we're all committed to. In fact, all of the ornithological societies have been working together on a joint code of ethics that'll be like the code of conduct for every meeting. There is a code of conduct that everyone must abide to when they register. And there is a process for if there's a violation of that. So if you have an experience in which you think something should be reported, that mechanism exists. That mechanism has been sort of shared with you, so you know how to do that. We'll talk about it every day. Every day of the conference, there'll be like an opening statement, and that will include a reminder of the code of conduct. And there's a formal process for reviewing that stuff. There are formal sanctions for people who violate the code of conduct. And so everyone knows they're protected. There's also an appeals process. And it's a very formal process. It's basically we're holding people, especially people who might be university folks, we're holding them to at least the same standards that their universities do. So things that they wouldn't attempt to get away with on their campus, they're not getting away with at our conferences. And these things really do have teeth, and they're serious. And the whole point though is to keep everyone safe. So it's an opportunity to network and learn and enjoy yourself and not have to worry about anything else. And social media policy, there are reasons why some people might not want their information shared on social media. Sometimes it's just someone is very private and they don't want any mention of themselves on social media. That's totally fine. Sometimes it's about the research itself. Maybe it hasn't been published yet and people are worried about like little pieces of that information getting out there before they've put a manuscript together. So just familiarize yourself with whatever the social media policy is at your conference. At the upcoming Wilson conference next month, we are an opt-out conference. And that means so that if someone is speaking in their contributed talk or on their poster, if they don't want any of their information shared on social media, they will have some sort of an insignia like the one on the slide there with the little strike through on a Twitter bird. And that's how you know, do not post any of that stuff to social media. If you do, that would be a violation of the code of conduct. And you're talking about virtuals, right, Jen?
Yeah. So I just realized what the time was. We've got a couple of slides left and then we'll open it up. If anyone knows Tim and me, they'll know we like talking. Sorry. So we have a couple of slides left. Just I'll quickly run through these and give everyone an opportunity to ask questions. And so with the COVID pandemic, a lot of conferences went online. Who knows what conferences will look like in the future, but I think it's important just to mention here tips for virtual conferences, because who knows, but I wouldn't be surprised if conferences either become hybrid or virtual to some extent. We learned a lot about that process during COVID, and I think there's benefits for them. So just briefly, if you are attending a virtual conference, a lot of the things we said throughout the presentation are totally relevant. Some additional ones for virtual, schedule time to participate. It's really easy if you're sat at home to have a million things going on. Maybe you're trying to write your thesis and you're like, yeah, I can totally do this at going to a conference. Probably it's going to be a bit challenging. So find yourself time in your schedule to solely focus on on the conference. Similarly, turn off emails. I am terrible at being on my email all the time. When I was at the virtual conferences, I made a point of turning that off, right? Make your environment comfortable. There's nothing worse than sitting in a dark room, or, well, maybe for, at least for me, maybe other people are different, but you know, I want to make sure that I'm in a nice environment, free of clutter and you know, that kind of thing. Tim shaking his head or like nodding, but different people have different ways. Whatever the how you like your environment, make sure it's comfortable for you. And then take breaks. Don't feel you need to go to everything. Get away from your desk, take some walks. That's really important too. And then your conference is over. So what's next? So it shouldn't just stop the moment that you walk away from the conference. There's important things that you can do to maximize the success of the conference. So if you've taken notes, organize them and file it in an appropriate place. I'm kind of guilty for like taking notes and having them in some kind of binder in a random part of my office for a few years. I'm like, oh yeah, I met so-and-so 3 years ago. I should touch base with them. It's not that bad, but you get my point. So try and be organized, follow up with people who you've met as soon as you get back, so they don't forget you, or you don't forget who they were. There's nothing worse than having a random name and like something like, oh, avian speciation, and then you're like, who's that? And you have to Google them. And anyway, try and be on top of things, you know. Evaluate the success of the conference. I often sit down with students in my lab and we discuss collectively, including myself, about what we got out of the conference and what we could do differently, and was the conference the correct one for us to go to as a team, or that kind of thing. So take that opportunity to sit down and reflect on the conference with peers and advisors, for example. And with that information, you can kind of think about your approach for your next conferences. So I think with that, Tim and I can take any questions that you have. And thank you for listening to our presentation, which I'm sorry went a bit over, but no surprise given me and Tim.
I blame me.
Thanks, Tim. And as I said before, you can follow up via email with any questions as well.
You want to unshare?
Shh, I can do that.
Got a question in the chat.
Yeah, so I'll just repeat the questions as they come through. So would you recommend attending paper talks or plenaries more? And so this, I've got numerous answers to this. If it's about a choice in terms of timing, plenaries usually happen on their own. So there's often not paper talks at the same time. And so there's no kind of time conflicts there. If it's a question about, you know, maybe I want a break in the schedule, would you go to a plenary or a talk? I think for me personally, it would very much depend on what the plenary was about or what the paper talk was about. I always think about things in terms of like maximizing the benefits to me. So it very much depends. Like if it was, for example, a student in my lab giving a talk versus a plenary, I would go to the talk my student gave because you know, I want to support them to the best of my ability. But it very much depends on the person. I don't know if Tim's got any additional input.
No, that's great advice that you're giving, Jen. It's just like, is it whatever's most interesting to you, and you shouldn't have to choose between them because they wouldn't be happening at the same time. Most plenaries are really great talks. It's rare. It does happen that somebody will deliver a stinker, but most of the time when I go to a plenary, I'm just sitting there like enthralled, usually because there's somebody at that level who's getting the opportunity to do that. They're either a really great scientist who's like young and has a really cool story to tell, or there's somebody more senior who's just got like 40 years of like incredible data that they're sharing, and it's always worth it. one of the things that that you touched on a while ago, Jen, I think is really important to point out, talking like training, workshop training, and talking to vendors, especially you mentioned like cellular tracking technologies and learning more about that sort of thing, and having that one example you gave of the specific workshop on attachment of transmitters and things like that. For people getting involved in research careers, if that's work, the kind of work you want to do, or you know, you're starting a new program and you know that that kind of work is going to be involved, anything that's handling birds, for example, to get the permits to do that, you need to demonstrate proficiency, and you need to demonstrate and sort of quantify the training that you've had, or else you won't get the permit to do that work. So going to our conferences and seeing that there might be some specific training in that regard can be the difference between you getting to work on the project you're going to work on or not. So you need to get that experience somewhere, and a conference is very often a great place to get that.
I will say, I've been to a couple of most of the conferences I go to by myself. I haven't had the benefit of going with a lab, but every time I just walk up to a random person and introduce myself, it doesn't matter how big their name is, everyone's been super friendly, and they haven't just stared at me wondering why I'm walking up to talk to them. And I don't even have to have a question. I just have to go up and introduce myself, and then generally people want to know more about you and what you're working on. So it hasn't been at all awkward, and I found that has been a good way to meet people without having someone to introduce you.
Actually, to that point, Nikki just asked a great question. Thanks, Nikki. So to repeat, I will be going to the AOS conference, my first conference alone. Any tips on blending in and making connections? I think as Jess just said, find Jess. I'm super jealous. I'm not going to be going, so I would say come find me too, but go find Jess. You know, I've been to a lot of conferences, mainly ornithology ones, but a bit across disciplines. The ornithology profession are super friendly people. As Jess said, just go and introduce yourself. That can be really definitely taxing for some people, and I absolutely understand that. Sometimes you can go to kind of these student mentor mixes, and that can be a better way to kind of find some folk you can hang out with or who could introduce you to people. I know this sounds funny, but often I go and talk to vendors, and they often know people, and you will find that people will say, hey, do you want to come, we're going for a lab meal tonight, you're more than welcome to attend. Especially if you say, hey, I'm on my own, you will find a community pretty quickly. In my experience, when I've attended meetings by myself, I found communities pretty quickly, and it's been a really good experience.
I got to say, I'm really happy that folks who are going to the AOS meeting have chimed in today. I was hopeful that we'd get some folks coming in because that's the next meeting that's coming up.
Yeah, I love it that you guys are sharing emails. It's amazing. Good. Yeah.
Look, we're already building community.
Yeah. And also, as I said, follow the conference on social media. Oftentimes people will write things on Twitter like, hey, I'm at this conference. Does anyone want to chat or meet about, I don't know, avian migration or whatever, you know? And so keeping an eye on that can help build a sense of community and community in general. Yeah, exactly. Slack channel. Get on the Slack channel. Which sounds funny for me. Matt will probably be laughing right now because I'm a little anti-Slack, but it does help, and you can meet people on it. In just for reference, I'm like a little I don't use social media as much as other people. I think it's the best way to put it.
I resisted Slack for so long, and I think for this upcoming conference season,
I got on it because of
any. Really downloaded the app. I downloaded the app.
Yeah,
that's the only time I use it, is like during a conference, but it's useful during the conference.
Yeah, I can also say for room shares, I found on Twitter, people will usually tweet about looking for room shares using the conference hashtag, so that can also be a good way for room shares.
Yeah.
And for the Wilson meeting upcoming, that's probably something I need to do this next week, is make sure we get a room share, you know, opportunity for people to talk about that. So we'll get that advertised. Mm-hmm.
Any last questions? Has Dan Clem got some questions?
No, he's too busy learning. Thank you very much.
Now you finally know how to call.
By the way, can I just comment that the two of you are very well organized, and anyone listening would have come away with a pockets full of great advice. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Dan. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Dan.
Appreciate it. And thanks to Jess for putting this together. Much appreciated as always.
Well, I mean, it's entertaining just watching you two go back and forth, so on whatever topic. So yeah,
we're an entertaining duo, thank right?
We've got to take this gig on the road.
I'm just gonna recommend that.
Cool. All right, I actually need to head to Galveston to do field work right now. So unless anyone's got any questions, I'm going to dash to my lab.
You can dash. I'll stick around for another couple of minutes.
I can stick around if people got questions.
See you, Dan.
Bye.
Cheers, Dan.
Good luck with field work.
Of course, Nikki, we can do that. So mine is, and we, I think, Jess, what's happening with the recording and the presentation?
Yes, so we are recording all of this. And if you guys want to send us the presentation as well, if you don't mind sharing it, then we can, we will send that link out to the members. It'll go out to Wilson and AFO members. So people who weren't able to watch it can watch it. And those who want to watch it again can watch it again.
Perfecto. I'm going to watch it tonight.
There you go.